Hey guys, before we get started on this week's episode, I just want to stop and say thank you, because you guys have been amazing. You've blown us away with all the feedback that you've given us online, in person, and with your Apple Podcast reviews, and that just means the world to us. So I just want to say thanks, and I hope you'll keep sharing Maybe God with your friends and your family, especially people that just have a lot of questions about God and faith, people that may describe themselves as non-religious or skeptical. There's nothing I love more than engaging these folks in meaningful conversations. And so if you love Maybe God, and if this podcast has spoken to your heart in some way, just go ahead and open your Apple Podcast app right now. And if you haven't done so already, go ahead and leave us a review. Every single positive review that we get really helps get Maybe God out there, and it helps new listeners find us, and hopefully that makes a difference in their lives. So thank you so much for helping us spread the word. We can find millions of reasons why we're all different, but there's one question that every human ponders at some point in their lives. How did we get here? No one knows. Maybe we're a cosmic accident, or maybe God did it. I'm Eric Huffman. This is Maybe God. So welcome to episode 4, you guys. This is a sequel from last week's episode, and we got so much response from the conversation we had with Deb Hirsch that we're going to continue the talk about sex and sexuality. So if you missed episode 3, I encourage you to go back and listen to it. But Deb Hirsch is a pastor and a speaker and author of a book called Redeeming Sex, and she really makes it her life's mission to challenge primarily the way Christians think and talk about sex and sexuality issues in our culture today. We've got a little bit more of Deb's wisdom and insight to share with you later. She addressed some listener questions when we were with her in Los Angeles. But before we get to Deb's responses to listener questions, we had so many other listener questions come in since episode 3 aired. And so we wanted to spend some time wrestling with those questions. And I haven't really sat with these questions. I don't really know what's coming. This is going to be a fun conversation. We're going to be blushing here behind the mics, but producer Julie Miller-Courtois has a few questions that that she selected that came in via email and Facebook. And so Julie, what do you have for us?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. So, okay, first, Eric, a lot of our listeners wanted to know your thoughts on what's happening today with our hookup culture. Many people see casual sex as a way to have fun, relieve some stress, make friends, fulfill some, you know, basic need for human connection, especially while they're waiting to find the one and get married, which seems to be happening later and later these days. So what are your thoughts on hookup culture today?
Yeah, first of all, I think it's a little bit related to the Christian idea of purity culture, right? So the idea that many of us grew up with, if you grew up in religion or around Christianity, the idea that you're more valuable when you're single, you're more valuable on the dating scene as a virgin, especially true for young women, but to a lesser extent, men, as young men as well. And I think the question really is, it's about premarital sex. When I hear this, that's where my mind goes, is are we really still saying that it's wrong and it's a sin for people to have premarital sex? Because it just seems so out of touch. And people have really already settled this in their minds a lot of the time. I mean, the overwhelming majority of people that I counsel and couples that I see, they've already engaged in sex with each other and with multiple people before they met each other. And so that's part of the question, but that's not the whole question that you asked. You asked about hookup culture, which is a little different than having sex with someone you're in a relationship with, right? So hookup culture is having sex with whoever at a party, after a party, just after class, whatever. And that's a different thing to me. When I hear hookup culture, it seems like the norm there is to treat each other like a means to an end, to use each other, I think. And we're just kind of using each other as vehicles for some kind of satisfaction. And then when you're done with someone, you're done with them. It's like people are disposable. And so I think that's the ugly side of hookup culture, is it takes something that's so beautiful and sacred and intimate and wonderful, something like sex, and it makes it into something that at the end of the day just kind of feels disposable and a little gross. I hear a lot of people voicing regrets about hookup culture. So I've actually given a talk about this very thing before, and I started the talk by quoting one of my favorite childhood artists, the great Sir Mix-a-Lot. A wise man once said, "I like big butts. I cannot lie." Sir Mix-a-Lot seemed to not have a choice in the matter in terms of what makes a woman sexy. I think he kind of came prepackaged that way. Like, he came with that preference, as do, according to the latest science, and yes, there's science around this, 85% or so of straight men like the same things Sir Mix-a-Lot likes. Somehow at the University of Texas, I have no idea how they did this, but they found hundreds of willing male volunteers between the age of 18 and 35, and they showed them thousands of female figures. And they discovered that it didn't really matter how large that part was. The spinal curvature is what mattered. And they discovered over thousands of studies that the ideal female curvature in her spine is something like 45.5 degrees. And women are like, "Which one am I?" Don't even worry. And so the question in the scientist's face was, why? And here's what they think. They think that before all the medical advances that we've got today, before all the gynecological advances that we have today, that 45.5 degree spinal curvature was the ideal spinal curvature for a woman to carry multiple pregnancies to term and to give birth to multiple children who were healthier than others, and it allowed a woman to recover more quickly. It wasn't because of how she looked in a dress. It wasn't because of how it moved when she walked. It wasn't because of how hot she looks when she twerks. Our ancestors preferred this as a survival mechanism. So guys, when you reduce a woman's worth down to her body type, when you give or impute a woman's value based on how looking at her figure makes you feel, guys, when you take that obligatory second look, you're not just being a man, you're being a caveman. And women, I'm not going to let you off the hook because you're not that much better either. So my question as we talk about sex today is, how much longer are we going to think and talk about sex as if we're Neanderthals?
We know. So, Eric, that all makes a lot of sense. And this is my own follow-up question, really, because when I was there listening to you and Deb speak and hearing your answer on hookup culture, I still wonder, I think I know you enough to know that you still don't advocate for premarital sex. So what is wrong with premarital sex if it's not two people objectifying each other?
I think, while I appreciate the question, I think it's just not the best question to ask, because we're assuming, sin, and we're assuming purity culture kind of stuff. And that's not where my head's at all. I don't think it's where Deb's head was at either. I think instead of asking what's so wrong with premarital sex, I think the better question is, what's so right about valuing our sexuality so much that we're very protective about what we do with that and how we express ourselves sexually? Because the Bible I read and the Bible Deb talks about in our interview really lifts up sex and the human sexual experience as something to be celebrated and not to be ashamed of. And the God of the Bible doesn't just want people to have sex for procreation. The God of the Bible seems to want people to have the best, craziest, freakiest kind of sex together. So the question isn't, what's so wrong with premarital sex? The question is, what is it about waiting until we're sure, waiting until there's commitment, waiting until there's just you and only you, that covenant, right? What is it about that sets us up for the best sex that we can have together? I think that's the question the Bible really wants to tackle. And I know there's all kinds of verses you can point to and say, well, sexual immorality here and all these, you know, sins here and there. But the bigger story in the Bible about sex is how can two people experience the best form of human sexual expression? And my opinion is that the best form of that is in the context of covenant and in the context of love, and where there's just you and no one else. The other thing that that question does, I think, is it focuses on the past rather than the present and the future. And I think God is more interested in the present and the future than he is in the past. And I'm more interested in someone's present and future than I am in the past. Now, there's always some healing and conversations we need to have about our pasts when we're getting serious in a relationship and things like that. But I think the bigger question isn't, what have you done in the past? It's, what are you doing now? What choices are you making now? And in this, in the case of this conversation, what choices are you making sexually now that really celebrate the God-given gift of your sexuality, rather than just kind of giving that gift away to whomever and whenever?
So let's go to the next question from a listener in Houston. And I think what this man is really getting at is everything going on with the Me Too movement. So this listener says, in our society today, and especially as of late, sexual harassment and sexual assault is as pervasive, or at least it seems, as ever, with more and more evidence of that produced daily. How have we as a society gotten this wrecked to where sexual misconduct is commonplace? And how can we as Christians encounter this on a daily basis? So I think what he's asking here, Eric, is how do we get here, and what should we as Christians do to respond to it?
Yeah, that's a really great and loaded question. I'm not sure we have that might be its own episode right there, but it's I think it has to do with how accustomed we've become to objectifying ourselves and each other, and really boiling our sexuality and our sexual expressions down to purely physical, carnal acts. And that's all it is for us, at least culturally speaking. It's about how good you look and how sexy you look, and whether or not you have what it takes to blow his mind in bed, and all this, you know, like in the grocery store checkout lines, all the magazines, all the tips. It's just this mechanical act that we perform. It's performance. And I think performance naturally just leads us to objectifying each other rather than really valuing each other as spiritual beings, fully human beings. That's what Deb kept talking about when we kept pressing her and saying, how do we educate young people about sex, and how do we tell them what's right and what's wrong? And she just keeps telling us, you know, you need to pull back and teach them what it means to be a whole person. And I think that's in some ways a harder conversation to have, but it's such an important one to have. I think that we have come to a place in our culture where it's normal to kind of be what you would have been called in past times, like a perv. Right. I think when I talk to women, especially who are dating online, the kinds of things they say are, you know, it's not a question of whether a guy who IMs you is a perv, it's how bad a perv is he. And I just think we're just awash in sexual language and sexual expectations, that we just come at things from a very objectifying point of view. And I think that has a lot of implications as far as this Me Too moment that we're in. Men especially have grown accustomed to objectifying women and expecting certain responses from women. And they've gotten those responses from a few. And so it's entitled them in their minds to getting those responses from all. And the beauty of this moment is that women are standing up finally in mass and saying, no, we are fully human beings, and you will not objectify us and handle us in this way. And to their credit, I know a lot of men who are listening and changing the way they look at women. And I think this Me Too moment is good for us.
Great. And then what about the part about Christians? How should Christians respond to it?
Yeah, I think it's been a little disturbing at times, seeing the Christian response, hearing the Christian response to the feminist voice in our culture, it seems that those two are at odds when they shouldn't be. Because when I read the New Testament especially, I see a feminist voice arising in the movement of Jesus, where Jesus is empowering women all the time. And actually, the Apostle Paul is too, and putting women in leadership positions to speak in churches and things like that. And so to me, the movement of Jesus is by its very nature a Me Too feminist movement. And I know sometimes those voices in our culture get carried away, and actually you start to hear some of the same little traces of hate and bigotry on that side of it. If you listen long enough, there's extreme voices on both sides, right? But the heart of it is good. I think it's a holy message that women are in every way equal to men, and we should lift that up.
So, Eric, I had to laugh because, you know, we're so used to, at the Story Houston, you telling us about your past.
Yes.
But new listeners are not, especially the agnostic and atheist listeners. Out of all the things you and Deb talked about, it seems like they were most shocked by you, a Christian pastor, coming clean about a past porn addiction. That's what a lot of people wrote in about. So this leads to the question on a lot of their minds, what's really wrong with porn?
Yeah, I guess I've gotten a little too comfortable talking about my own story. I don't have a problem opening up about it. I think it's good when people talk about stuff like porn, because there's no one who's been unaffected by this rampant cultural phenomenon that has taken place over the last 20 years, this sudden unlimited availability of pornographic material, and how porn itself has changed in that time. And I know nobody is talking about this, especially not in churches, because no one wants to admit that they've seen it. And so when I talk about the difference between, you know, 1970s porn versus 2000s porn, I think that's where people get shocked, because that is an admission of sorts that I have viewed, you know, porn from different decades and things like that, which is just the truth. I have. And I think without outing anyone, I just think everyone has. And the question is whether or not it's an addiction, whether or not it's a problem. And I can't speak for everyone. I can just speak for myself. And I look back at my story. I was exposed to pornography at a very young age. And so when I was 7 years old, 7 or 8, I saw my first real graphic pornography. My family had a satellite dish, one of those huge ones back in the backyard. And so I was privy to that at an age when I just wasn't ready to be. Then I think looking back, I just didn't know what I was really getting into, but the habit of it formed before my body even formed, you know? And so for me, it behaved, that thing behaved and was acted out just like an addiction is. So it starts with a void of some kind. And I think the void often is just affection, or I think what I was missing was a real conversation about what was happening to me and my body as it developed and things like that. No one was having those conversations, really. My parents, I love them, and they did try here and there, but it's just a very sheltered culture. But other people have different kinds of needs that they fulfill, or they try to fulfill, with something like porn. And so I think it starts there, just like any addiction does. It starts with the void. And then the problem with it is that, just like every addiction, there is a law of diminishing returns. So what satisfies you one day doesn't do it for you the next day, in terms of amount of times and content. And so if you're looking at 70s era porn one day, and there's a pizza delivery guy and, you know, consenting adults seeming to have a really good time together, and that satisfies you on Monday, by Wednesday, you're done with that. It doesn't do it for you anymore. It's just how the human mind works. You need something else. And so suddenly there's two pizza delivery guys, you know, and one girl, or, you know, more or whatever, and just how it works. And eventually you've become something. you've developed an appetite you never would have imagined having on day one. And I think that's how addiction just works. I've counseled people who have been addicted for 5-10 years, and the stuff they're into now, if you had told them that this is what they would be into on day one of their addiction, they would think you're crazy. Just unbelievable stuff. But the human mind, our bodies and our minds, they just constantly need something more than you had the day before. And so for me, I definitely saw that. I got into different kinds of porn over time. And what's interesting about porn, I think one of the things that's dangerous about it, in addition to how it is highly addictive and how it rewires our brains, is that porn itself has changed to the extent that now, instead of two consenting adults seeming to kind of enjoy themselves and in a role-playing kind of a way, that's what porn was in the 70s and the 80s. Now, it's usually, most porn today is a man doing something to a woman. Instead of two people together, I mean, I'm not going to tell my listeners to go and do your own research. Just, you're going to have to trust me here if you're not into this. But like, that's what 90% of the porn is that's out there, is what is a man doing to a woman. And much, if not all, definitely most of the language around what men do to women in porn is stuff you would not want to be done to your daughter. It's violent. It's words like destroy, wreck, ruin, you know, stuff like that, which is just by nature objectifying of the woman. It is very one-sided. And I think even when I listened to an interview the other day of with a porn star, Ron Jeremy, and Ron Jeremy's kind of transcended the porn world. He's everywhere. Everybody kind of knows who he is. He was reaching his peak of fame in the 80s in the porn world. And he says in an interview, I don't even know what's going on with porn anymore. I look at porn, I don't recognize it. Like the extreme of it. And this is the mainstream porn is so extreme that to him it's unrecognizable. He says, I'm nostalgic for the way porn used to be back when it was fun. And now there's something ugly and dark about it.
Going back to your personal story, you mentioned in episode 3 how you were a virgin until you married your wife, Giovanna, at 19?
We had just turned 20.
You just turned 20. Okay. So how did porn affect your relationship when you guys got married?
Yeah, I think I thought that while I was deep in my addiction with porn before we got married, I thought that when we got married, I wouldn't need it anymore because we'd be having sex all the time. You know, that's what I thought marriage meant. And little did I know, that's not necessarily what it means. And so I brought all these expectations into my marriage that she had no idea about. She had no idea that I expected her to do certain things or say certain things or respond in certain ways. But my brain had been rewired in so many crazy ways I wasn't even aware of. So I brought all that into the marriage. She didn't, obviously. And so we were starting on an unequal plane. And then we had all these problems sexually that really prevented us from connecting in that way for a long time. So I went back to porn and I relied more on porn. And in that way, in the early years of my marriage, I justified it as though I was letting her off the hook. So if sex was an unpleasant thought for her because we were having these issues, I thought, well, I'm gonna leave her alone. I'll do porn and then we'll watch a movie after. You know, that kind of thing. It's just the way you justify it is also the way addiction works. But yeah, marriage didn't fix my problem. I had to do that work later.
So this all leads to another set of questions we got from listeners about masturbation, which you and Deb talked about in your interview. Let's hear what Deb had to say about that.
We've got kind of a similar question from a young woman in my congregation. She says, I became sexually active at a young age. My circle of friends and family, not to mention media and magazines, all supported the worldview that sex was something to be experienced well before marriage, the old try before you buy adage. I became a Christian at 31. Throughout my walk with Jesus, I've been convicted to wait for sex until marriage. This has been both a huge blessing and a huge struggle. I'm now dating a man who shares this belief, and we keep each other accountable. However, I'd like to know your thoughts on orgasm and masturbation in singleness. The Bible doesn't refer explicitly to them, as far as I know.
I've come to, you know, a place now where I will say to people on the, you know, the masturbation, the M question, I would never say it's absolutely wrong or it's absolutely right. I think it really is something that we need to work out according to our conscience. Let me give you an example. I remember years ago when I was working as an addictions counsellor, I had a gay man who was acting out a lot, was having a lot of anonymous sex, like regularly, sometimes several times a day, go off to, you know, beats where, you know, where he would have anonymous encounters. And I found myself saying to him at one point, oh, for goodness sake, can't you just masturbate? And I remember as the words were coming out of my mouth, I was thinking, am I really saying this? Am I really encouraging him? And I realized it's much better for him to do that. You know, it's a step in the right direction than actually have somebody else involved. So, you know, so that as part of, you know, walking towards helping him to come become.
Yeah, it's not perfect, but it's better.
Yes, you know? That's right. And, you know, this guy wasn't going to be able to go cold turkey. Some people can do that, you know, grit their teeth and get through it. Other people, it's a slow, it's like sometimes coming off drugs or it's other addictions. So that was on the one hand. In the same time period, we had a single guy that was part, a heterosexual guy, who I remember having a conversation with him and about masturbation. And he's like, oh, I just masturbate when I feel like it. And I said, hang on a minute. And I found myself saying to him, no, you can't just any time you feel like masturbating. I mean, is that real freedom? Is that what you're calling freedom? There's got to be a level of discipline there. So I found myself saying to him, no, you need to discipline yourself, mate. This is not good. And yet here's this other man I was saying that. So I've come to a place now where we're all in different places with that, and people masturbate for different reasons. One young guy that I was counseling at one time said it was the only time he felt free. And that, again, that points back to what we spoke about earlier, that sense of transcendence or ecstasy where you almost lift it out of the worries of the world of today. You know, there's something powerful in that. But again, it's a taste of heaven that God's giving us, isn't it?
Right.
So I think we have to be careful with it. Not absolutely no and not absolutely yes. There's got to be a sense of moderation according to where you're at and also your relationship with God. And the complicating part for some people is the pornography that yes. often goes hand in hand with that. And that, honestly, how can pornography ever be healthy or helpful?
Wow, yeah, Eric, that reminds me a lot of your answer related to porn.
Yeah, I hear what Deb's saying there. And I think my own experiences with porn have jaded me. I'm not sure I would ever say that porn could ever be healthy or helpful, at least for me, because of how destructive I've seen it be. But I guess the question that we're really getting at here is where should we draw our lines about what's healthy and what's not healthy? And should it be left up to each person individually to decide what's healthy and right for me and to each his own kind of a deal? Or should there be some governing body? Like in past times, past generations have looked to the church or to organized religion to govern that, to police our sexual mores. And I'm not sure how I feel about that. So I actually asked Deb what she thinks about the church governing people's sexual expressions. And I found her answer fascinating.
I think, and I feel quite strongly about this, let me just say, I think if a church has a standard of celibacy for singles, then we need to have other conversations. Conversations around, first of all, around celibacy. What is celibacy? Because right now, when I speak to single people, celibacy feels like they've been sentenced to solitary confinement for their whole lives. Most single people feel half-born, incomplete, and lacking God's blessing because they don't have a partner. And again, that's the kind of culture we've developed in the church today where to be married is to the be all and end all. That's kind of where we're heading.
Right.
You know, and broader culture looks at people that are walking the path of celibacy as at the very best suspicious.
Absolutely.
At the worst, you know, well, you there's outcast. Something wrong with you. You've got nobody psychological hang-ups and, you know, repressed and suppressed and all that kind of stuff. So we've got to begin to change a conversation around celibacy and begin to, again, go back to some of the heroes of the faith that have walked a celibate path. And again, this is where Jesus comes back in. Like, who's going to say Jesus was repressed or suppressed or psychologically hung up, you know?
Right.
But all throughout history, we see these people that have given their lives to the Lord. They see themselves married to the Lord. Now, that might sound a bit weird and all the rest of it, but Paul talks a lot about union with Christ. And what does union with Christ mean? And he actually encourages people, if you can, remain celibate, do. Because there is a gift to be found there. Now, many of our young people that are walking the celibate path do not see it as a gift.
It's a curse.
They see it as a curse.
Paul called marriage the curse.
That's exactly right. And so, again, we've got to change the conversation around so that people are not seeing it as a negative thing, but as this positive, beautiful thing. That's the first thing for churches that hold an ethic of no sex before marriage. The second thing is, the other conversation that is profoundly important is the conversation around family, because at the moment when we talk of family or we understand family, we're very caught up in the nuclear family concept, particularly in the West, where family is about me and my wife or my husband, my 2.2 kids, my car and little house and all the rest. Jesus speaks very strongly about family, and he redefines it, not along biological lines, but along the family of God lines. You know, I love that little story where his mum's trying to get hold of him, and of course there's probably crowds all around him, and the disciples come in and say, "Hey, Jesus, your mum's out there, she needs you." And I laugh because, you know, I'm married to a Jewish man, and you do not reply like this to a Jewish mama.
Jewish mother, yeah.
So Jesus is like, "Huh? Who's my mother, my father, my sister?" You know, and what is he saying in that? I mean, there's a lot there. And he goes on, he doesn't just say it once. He says it a number of times. What he's doing is he's bringing a new family. He's saying we are not bound just by our biology and our biological lines or our bloodlines. We're bound by who we're in relationship with, by our God family. And if we are calling people to walk the path of celibacy, that can be a very lonely path if they're not in community. So when we started our first church back in Melbourne, we had a lot of people that were messed up in our early years who needed healthy relationships to restore them, to bring wholeness to them. And so we set up a lot of community houses, and a lot of people lived with each other. I mean, Alan and I have lived our whole married life in community.
Hmm.
We had 1 month alone when we were first married, and we also chose not to have children so that we could both be available to be involved in ministry. So what we were doing in our very lives was really redefining what it is to be family. And my sister and her hubby, who had a couple of kids, they had two single gay men that lived with them. And they were so much part of a family that those two guys became known as the third and fourth sons.
Oh, wow.
That's what I mean by, you know, we've got to change our understanding of family to a much more extended family understanding.
I want to thank Deb for sharing her wisdom with us. If you want to hear more from her, I really encourage you to get her book, Redeeming Sex. You can find it on Amazon or wherever you buy books. So I have asked our producers, Julie and Brandon, and our sound guy, Patrick, to leave the room for this last part. So now it's just me and my dog, Limp Biscuit, who's old and deaf, and this microphone and all of you. And I wanted to share the last part of the porn story that I shared earlier in this episode. But I didn't feel super comfortable doing it with the rest of the team sitting right here in front of me. This part's a little uncomfortable, but it's a good story, I think. When my wife found out about my issue with porn, it obviously was ugly, and she was obviously destroyed by it, and she had so many questions. And everything really kind of came crashing down, and it just seemed like, to her, like our whole life together had been a lie. And to me, obviously, I just had all these feelings of defensiveness and insecurity coming to the surface. And I just remember the night that it happened, and we were there sobbing, both of us, in our living room, not really sure what our next steps were. And I had a choice to make. I could have said, "Hey, relax, it's not a big deal, all guys watch porn," right? Or I could have said, "Hey, you know, if you had made a little bit more of an effort in the bedroom, or if you had gone to greater lengths to be sexier to me or whatever," I could have put it on her, right? Or I could have said, "Hey, it's really not a problem. You know, somebody from work just sent me a link and it was one little slip up. It'll never happen again. I'm not that kind of guy." Now, all three of those things would have been lies, but I could have said them in theory. But instead, in that moment, something that's totally not in my nature moved inside of my heart and it moved me and led me to just be broken and honest. And I remember exactly what I said to my wife that night. I looked across the room at Gio and I said, "I need you to treat me like I'm sick." And without knowing what I really meant, without understanding the depth of my addiction and how dark my world had gotten, without asking more questions like, "How long have you been lying to me?" and "Why am I not enough for you?" and "What's wrong with me?" she came over to me and she wrapped her arms around me and she said, "We can get through this. God can put us back together again." That moment was like a turning point for us in our marriage, and ever since, our life together has been so different. We talk more than ever, we touch more than ever, and not to gross out those of you who know us personally, but we probably made love more in our 18th year together than any other year before. Our marriage, our sex life, it just keeps getting better. The thing I'm trying to say with that story, and what I want to suggest with this whole episode, is that the reason the Bible seems to so many to be so prohibitive about sex isn't because sex is so bad. I think it's because sex is so good. It's really never been that God just wants to punish people for having the wrong kind of sex. I think he just doesn't want us to miss out on the best kind of sex, the best sex of our lives. When I chose to turn all my attention and my energy away from porn and fantasy and directed it toward my wife, and when she chose to forgive me and meet me halfway, we discovered something so much more than just intercourse or orgasm or whatever. We, pardon the cliche, we learned how to make love. And when two human beings cross that threshold together, when they know that what they share together is sacred and private, and they can say and do anything in those moments without fear of judgment or shame, that is the best sex on earth. Some people have gotten the idea that the God of the Bible is warning against sexual freedom and against sexual freakiness. But what if, consider this, what if the whole time God has been trying to show us the best way to be free and freaky? I'm not saying you're going to go to hell if you're breaking the rules or if you're living outside these boundaries. I'm not saying that you're worthless on the dating scene or you'll never get married if you've been promiscuous. That's not it at all. I'm saying it just helps when we look at the rules to understand why the rules are there to begin with. Sexual boundaries are not about control. They're about freedom. An athlete cannot excel at his sport until he knows what's out of bounds. An artist can't create something beautiful until she understands the dimensions of her canvas. And these limitations don't stand in the way of expression. They make the expression possible and beautiful. Now, I know not everyone agrees with the sexual boundaries that are found in the Bible, and that's fine. You may not agree with me, and that's cool. But we all share one thing in common. We all have a sense in our minds of what's right and what's wrong when it comes to sex. Now, most Christians obviously believe it's one man and one woman forever in marriage. And we base that belief on our understanding of God, our understanding of covenant and gender and all those things. But everyone else has boundaries too. Even the most secular, most liberal person reaches a point on the sexual spectrum where they say, "Hey, no, that's wrong. That sexual expression is wrong." So I'd just like to wrap up this two-part conversation by asking you to consider two questions. And if you'd like to share your responses with me, I would love to hear them. You can send them to maybegodpod@gmail.com. I'm actually really curious to hear what you have to say about this. It's been on my mind a lot lately. Here are the questions. First, where do you draw the line between right and wrong when it comes to human sexual expressions? And second, on what basis do you draw the line there? On what basis do you say this all is right and that's wrong? Is it scripture or is it law or is it just a feeling? What basis is it that you get that idea from? I'm just asking that you give those questions some thought and that you send me your ideas, and maybe we'll keep the conversation going in some future episodes later this season or next season. Guys, thank you for opening your hearts to me. This has not been an easy conversation, but I hope it's been helpful to some of you in some way. Thank you for listening to episode 4 of Maybe God.
How you doing, young lady? The feeling that you're giving really drives me crazy. You don't have a play about the choke. I was at a loss for words first time that we spoke.
If you're looking for a girl that'll treat you right, if you're looking for it in the daytime with the light,
you might be the type if I play my cards right. I'll find out by the end of the night.
You expect me to just let you hit it, but will you still respect me if you get it?
All I can do is try, give me one chance. What's the problem? I don't see the ring on your hands.